First, help us understand how we're going to shift from our main table, which is where we are right now, into the other table.
Okay, before I do that, just so everybody knows, I just turned on, I am recording this video session. So if anybody doesn't want to be recorded, you can mute your picture. If you go to the Zoom window where you can see everybody else who's attending the conference, if you click on the lower left-hand corner, if you move your mouse down, a gray bar will pop up across the whole bottom of the screen. On the lower left, there's a mute button for the microphone. There's also a mute for the video. So if you don't want to be recorded, you can mute yourself or if there's noise in the background. Okay, once we start, I am going to mute everybody except for the person speaking, because sometimes if a volume is turned up a little bit too loud, we can get feedback. So as a matter of fact, let me just do that now. Okay, so you will be able to unmute yourself if you have something to say. So right now, everybody should be muted but me. Okay, so a couple of things that I wanted to talk about. As I already mentioned, you will want to move from the Zoom screen to the notes page, the KikoChat web browser screen, if you want to add any notes. We'll talk more about that in a minute. In order to see both screens simultaneously, if you want to, you might have to resize the windows. If somebody doesn't know how to do that, please raise your hand and I'll give you a 30-second brief tutorial on how to resize windows so you can put both the Zoom window and the KikoChat web browser window side by side so you can see both at the same time. Okay. Linda talked about the site-wide chat. If you click on it, a window will open up, a chat window, and you can record anything that you want other people to know about, and we'll go over that at the end of the event. The one on the right, which is the teleconference chat, please use that one only if you're having technical issues. I will be monitoring that one, so if somebody gets stuck, I will be able to help you out, hopefully. I might ask for a phone number if you're having a problem, so I might have to call you. If for some reason or other you get knocked out of KikoChat out of Zoom, you can always come right back in to this event the same way you did the first time. So don't worry about the session has already started or whatever. We've had on a couple of occasions, people have had things running in the background that messed up their computer, and the only way they could get back into the session was to reboot the computer and then rejoin. Okay, if you want to rejoin just by telephone, I can give you a phone number and a session ID if for some reason or other, let's say you need to go somewhere and you want to continue participating in the event. You can use your smartphone as an audio-only device, still hear everything that's going on, and be able to communicate. We're recording now, and I guess I've covered everything I want to. So Sharon Joy, unmute your mic, and it's all yours.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Linda. Before, let me first ask, is there anyone that wanted to ask Bob a clarifying question? And here's the way we found works. Just wave. There's a feature over on the Kiko chat that said raise your hand, but I can't promise you I'll be looking at it. In fact, I'll tell you I won't. I'll be looking at you, and if you want to speak, raise your hand. So did you have a question of Bob? All good? Well, welcome everybody, and I'm delighted that we're here. Good conversation. I don't know about you, but on my way to talk about climate and climate change, I've noticed a distinct change of climate in our political scene. And it seemed timely because here we go. We're on a short track to November, and some of you have other elections in the meantime. So we just thought, looking at what's going on with climate around the conversations, the context within your communities would be a good topic. So what I'd like us to do, each of you, like I'll just model, is give your name and where you're sitting right now. And then really quickly, like a popcorn response, just a second or two, what's the one thing that jumps out at you about the current campaign season? So just a sentence. You'll have more time later on to carry on more about what else you notice. That'll be part of the dialogue. So I'll start and say, I'm Sharon Joy Kleitch. I'm grateful to be sitting here in beautiful St. Petersburg, Florida. And what's the one thing that jumps out at me is that I'm noticing what I'm interpreting to be a new climate of anger and actions expressing the anger. That's Sharon Joy. Who's next? Raise your hand. And take your foot off, take your mic off of mute. Thank you, Marty. Yeah. Next.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm Marty Roach. I'm in Moraga, California, right next door to Oakland. And one thing that jumps out at me is how the media is just glommed onto the circus aspects of the campaign, and the issues seem to be getting short shrift.
Thank you. Lloyd, what about you? Take your mic, excuse me, take your mute down in the left-hand corner, the mute button off. There you go.
Well, I just go along with what was just said. I was thinking that the media showed us they can be even more vacuous than they've been in previous elections.
And you're sitting in, you said Minneapolis?
Minneapolis, yes, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Bob, I think you were next. You're on mute.
Yes. Well, the only thing that I just want to reiterate what was just said, it's amazing that the most important issue facing humanity is hardly mentioned on any of the cable news networks or by any of the politicians. It's such a short-term focus. I'm in Boca Raton, Florida, by the way.
Well, welcome, Bob. Hi there. It's David, right?
Right. Yeah, so I'm David, and I'm in Irvine, California, the southern part of California, not far from Disneyland. You know, what I've really seen in the media is that they are becoming much more divided or whatever. So we have, you know, this media outlet talking liberal and this media outlet talking conservative. And it's just, it's not us talking about things together anymore. It's isolation. We're getting sort of isolated and segmented by media.
Thank you, David. Hi, Lenny. Welcome. You're on.
Okay, I'm unmuted. Can everybody hear me? Well, great. Hey, everybody. I am sitting in Nashville, Tennessee. And by the beginning of July, I will be sitting in Gainesville, Florida, organizing the Float the Vote for the Climate campaign, which we've already started. What stands out to me is that the state of Florida, with its 29 electoral votes, is the critical state on climate change, and that we must bring forth to everybody in that state the conversation that they have to make a decision on whether they believe that climate change is real and dangerous to the coastlines and to Florida and its future. And if they do, they need to register to vote, or if they're already registered, they need to vote for candidates of any party that understand the problem and are committed to creating solutions.
Glad you're here, Florida, lady. We'll pick you up. We'll pick some more up later. Hi, okay. Sue. Welcome. You're on mute. There you go.
There we go. I am in Hampton, Florida, north of Gainesville.
You went on mute again. You're on mute again.
Better. Okay. I say I'm in Hampton, Florida, north of Gainesville, looking forward to Lanny's arrival. He just spent a week here doing some climate education in Gainesville area. And so I just see the divisiveness and lack of concern about the topic of climate change as a great opportunity for us to fill a big void.
Thank you, Sue. Hi, Linda. And you're on mute. There you go.
So, yeah, I resonate with what many of you said. I think the thing that's hit me yesterday when I listened to some of the newscasting about the what the candidates were saying, et cetera, is that everyone now seems to be trying to decide what's the least bad candidate to vote for, which is really a state of our political system. I mean, that's horrible, the least bad candidate. And the only candidate that's talking about climate change, Bernie Sanders, gets very little shrift around that. So it's very sad.
Thank you, Linda. Hi, Guy. What about you?
Yeah, that's something that's been bothering me is that, you know, Bernie has these huge turnouts at rallies.
Guy, let me stop you again. Introduce yourself.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Guy Hancock. I'm here in Largo, Florida, part of Pinellas County, Tampa Bay area. And Bernie is getting very little coverage of the huge turnouts at the rallies. And it seems like the media has also just made up their mind that Hillary's the nominee. And the polls are showing that it's pretty close between her and Trump. But if you look at the polls between Bernie and Trump, he's got a significant lead. So I don't understand the reason behind all that.
Well, good. Glad your voice is here with us. Who's next?
This is Andrew. I can't raise my hand because I'm not on video.
Hi, Andrew.
I'm sitting in Katoomba, 2 hours outside of the Blue Mountains, outside of Sydney in Australia. We have gone into what's called a double dissolution election, which means everybody's up for grabs. The current prime minister has totally neglected climate change in the recent budget and making terrible cuts to our research facilities. Labor, on the other hand, has taken a definite, though weak, stand about climate, weak by our standards. And the race looks to be at the moment about 50-50, which is appalling. Why 50-50? Why not? So there we are.
Thank you, Andrew. Welcome. Hi there, Grady.
Hello, I'm Grady McGonigal, and I'm in Brookline, Massachusetts, which is right next door to Boston. I think this has a positive aspect to it. I think that both Trump and Sanders have helped us discover a group of people that have not been well served by either party, that have been left behind by, you know, the outsourcing of jobs and so forth. And so if there's a way that I think that there's positive potential here to better serve that group. My fear, and it was exacerbated by today's headlines, was a split between the environmental and the labor wing of the Democratic Party, which could hurt us.
Thank you. Glad to have you. Okay, is that you who hasn't spoken? I see a couple of numbers here. 831. Who's 831? You're on mute. Oh, hi.
Hello. It's Nancy Glock-Gernike at 831 in Santa Cruz, California.
Welcome.
And I'm going to pick. Thank you. Going to pick up on the other side of it. For the last few months and increasingly, I keep bumping into people in different organizations, campaigns, etc., who are astounded by the increase in energy engagement, involvement that they're unexpectedly experiencing, and they're not quite even sure where it's coming from. But I keep coming across that pattern, and I think it's the other side of what we're talking about. It's this election is positively crackling. That's it.
Thank you, Nancy. And I recognize a phone number, 813. Welcome, David. You're on mute. There you go.
I am from Tampa, Florida. Currently, I'm up here in the woods in northern Minnesota. I'm happy to join you. And what stands out to me, what does stand out to me is that many of us climate activists still seem to be in separate silos, often with separate messages.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think we've heard from everyone. Thank you for your observations. And as promised, now some time to dig more deeply into this. And we're going to test out this technology, which we're coming to get a little more comfortable with. So think about, besides the media, what you're hearing from different candidates, what you're hearing, and who might be standing up and speaking out, Republican or Democrat. So why don't, now, if I need to give you the question first before you get in a small group or you won't hear me, correct, Bob? Yeah, okay. So folks, here's the question. How are electoral issues and climate concerns converging, or are they? Hi there, Larry. Welcome. Let me stop before we get into the question. I'll repeat it again. And let's all welcome Larry. Larry, what we're doing is to give our name, where we're sitting, and in one short sentence, what is it that's popping up for you right now about the current political situation?
You want me to answer that now?
Yeah, we're just not a dialogue, simply what we're calling a popcorn intro. So we, and I've got your top of your nose and up. So if you could adjust your camera so we can
see. Okay, there we go. I see. Okay. So I've been 3 hours trying to get in here.
welcome. So
I the last one I was able to watch, but I wasn't able to get into.
We're glad to have you.
I'm a futurist. I'm interested in long-term change. I believe we can survive this crisis of crises, okay. Although I can't find anybody who's able to comprehend what I have to propose.
Larry,
at the time.
Where are you speaking from today?
Tucson, Arizona.
You're from Tucson. Great.
Yeah, I live a couple blocks from Eleanor.
Okay. So if you'll just quickly, in a sentence, tell us what you've noticed, what's standing out for you going on in the current political campaign season, climate that we're in.
Yeah, I am most concerned about the people, the mindsets of the people that follow Trump and others. That and I'm even concerned that the people that are following Bernie right now are doing it for very superficial reasons, and I can't sustain it. I'm really concerned that
Stop you, because we were just given a second or two, because we'll have lots of good time to carry on. Bob, you have a question.
Well, no, when you're ready, I just would like to walk everybody through how to switch to the individual table. So just let me know when you're ready to do that.
So why don't you walk them through that right now, and then I'll give them the question.
I don't think Larry's at a table yet, is he?
Oh, I'll take care of that. And
Nobody's at a table yet.
I'll put Larry in table one with me, and so you can all see which tables you're going to be in. So Bob, go ahead and explain how we're going to go.
I think that probably it's easier for anybody who's coming in by telephone to be part of the main table and not switch them to anyone else.
Okay, I'll change that then.
Good idea. Okay.
So that would make it easier. But if you have a split screen on your computer screen right now, and you can see Zoom on one side and the browser window on the other that has the Kiko chat screen, you will notice on the Kiko chat screen that Linda is assigning everybody to different tables, the main table, which you're at right now, table one and table two. First, we're going to answer the question for session one, the one that Sharon Joy has proposed and will repeat in a minute. if you look under on the left side of the Chrome browser or whatever browser you're using, under the pictures of all the participants, you will see a bunch of buttons called View Table 1, View Table 2, View, etc. You're currently at the main table, everyone is. Some of you are going to be moving to Table 1 and to Table 2, the way Linda has listed them on the right side of the web browser window. To go to a different table, you will notice that I've written the instructions on the top, step 1 through 5, above where your names are, on how to do that. I will walk you through it. The first thing, if you're assigned to table 1, you're going to click on View Table 1, and then a red button will appear just to the right of it. You're going to click, and it'll say Join Live Audio or Video. Okay. And then a pop-up on step number 2, another pop-up will come up. First you're going to say Launch Application. That's going to be a different Zoom session. Every table has its own Zoom session. So you're going to switch, you're going to launch the Zoom application again. And when you do that, eventually, don't do it yet, please, but eventually what's going to happen, your old Zoom window will disappear and a new one will come up for the participants at the table you just went to. Then you're going to click on another pop-up button that says you are in another meeting. Do you want to leave and join this meeting? Meaning table 1 or table 2, whatever you clicked on, click yes. Your image from your camera will now show up in a new window. The old window for Zoom will automatically close out. And then a new pop-up window will appear with a green button on it that says join audio by computer. Click that. This is the same sequence that you went through when you joined the live video at the main table. Okay, you can refer to the instructions. On lines 3 through 9, if anybody has any questions. But I think the instructions are fairly straightforward. So, Sharon Joy, are you ready to pose the question again and have everybody move?
I will, and let me remind us who did hear it and those who joined us newly. This main session is being recorded, and you can tap in and hear up where we are now and then hear the debriefs. The small groups will not be recorded. And I'm inviting each of you, if you're open to it, to use the space to take notes, because that's going to be the collective note taker. If note taking isn't your thing, that's fine too. So you've got the process down. I'm sure you'll do it smoothly. So let me repeat the question. I think Linda's put it in there. How are the electoral issues and the climate concerns that we have converging, or are they? Have fun. You've got 20 minutes.
Okay, and let me just explain who's in the main table because they can't see. So we have everyone on the phone. You're just going to stay where you are. And then we have Sharon Joy, Bob, David Sinclair, Nancy, David, and Andrew.
Yes.
Okay, so we'll see you in the...
I didn't follow any of those instructions from Bob, so you just go ahead and I'll see if I can follow along.
Larry, you're going to be with me. Okay. Just click on table 1 and then follow...
Where is table 1 to click on? I don't see anything to click on.
On the browser window.
Do you have Kiko chat up, Larry?
I don't see the browser window. All I see is a map of everybody's face.
You know what? I'm going to keep Larry in the main table. David Sinclair, can you come with me to table 1?
Well, David doesn't know the ID for the session for table 1. David has a telephone.
I thought he didn't. I thought, okay.
No, David's on the phone.
Okay. Okay, I see what you're saying. Okay, then we're just going to put Larry in with you. You're going to have a slightly larger group.
Okay.
All right. Well,
so
you
have 20 minutes, folks.
20 minutes.
I'm timing it at the hour, and my clock says
right,
3.
And Bob will be sending us a note that says to come back to the room.
And let me suggest, as you go into this first conversation, what we know a lot about is our own point of view. We're very knowledgeable with our own point of view. I'm going to encourage us to consider that there's more to gain by not speaking and learn from the wise people that are sitting there in your small group. So take on the challenge of monitoring your amount of conversation. We've got 20 minutes and you've got what, about four people in each room?
Mm-hmm.
So think about each of you having the space to speak, for one, and secondly, that how much wiser you can become by listening to some of the other people. Linda, did you have a comment? No, I guess you were waving goodbye. So see you around, folks, back in 20 minutes. Thank you.
Hello, this is David. I'm at the main table. Can folks hear me?
You are indeed. Now, wait just a second. Lloyd, you're going to move over to one of the groups, correct?
He's table one.
Bob, do you need to help Lloyd get to table one?
Raise your hand if you need help, Lloyd. No, he's gone.
He jumped. Okay, so welcome, folks. Here we are. I can see Bob and I can see Larry, and I know that Andrew's out there near Sydney, and I know that Nancy's there near Santa Cruz, and I know that David's up in the North Woods of Minnesota. So welcome to our small group. And again, what are the issues? What's coming up? Are they converging around climate or not? Who wants to jump in? David, you wanted to speak first, correct?
Yes, only because I'm never sure if people can hear me because I'm on the phone. Yes, thank you for the wonderful question, Sharon Joy. I believe that the issues of climate change and the presence of the electoral process are not really converging. I believe the reason is that listening to the speeches of the different candidates, the interviews, there seems to be a fear to use terms such as climate change. I do hear always the use of the terms alternative energy and the support for that. Candidates are not afraid to use those words yet, perhaps because the public thinks of those as simple solutions. A positive I see is that there's a candidate for U.S. House of Representatives in Florida named Tim Canova in U.S. District 23 who is using the words of climate change. So generally, in summary, I think that the issues are not yet converging. I don't expect them to converge anymore. I wish they would. Thank you.
Thank you, David. I'm not going to be the person calling on us. It's going to be tough for those of you who can't see, but invite you to jump in.
Well, I guess I will go while other people are still thinking about answers. We talk at each other. We don't talk to each other anymore. That's the sad shape of the political environment which we find ourselves in right now. I guess the good news is that more and more people than ever are getting concerned about climate change. I post a lot of articles on Kiko Chat, and almost daily I find an article on one of the news feeds that I use that has to do with some aspect of climate change, whether it's disease being more rampant, torrential rains, severe weather that's causing damage, sea level rise. Hardly a day goes by without at least some major publication now carrying articles, and that's very encouraging. And also, I think the good news is that it doesn't take everybody to raise the awareness. You only need to get a critical mass of people to get it in the public discourse. And I'm sure by the time the main election season starts, it will get into the conversation, probably not as much as I would like, but people are starting to see it. You can go to Miami right now during spring high tides, which occurs every month, and some of the main streets there, you see fish swimming in the streets. from the tidal surge that's just too low a level, and how long can you keep that hidden from other people? And when you consider the financial aspects of what all this, the property values and everything else that's associated with sea level rise, people are starting to get concerned. We have garbage trucks in Delray Beach that will not go on certain streets anymore because every time the seawater backs up through the sewers and floods the streets, the salt water corrodes the garbage trucks. So since they cost $750,000 a piece, the city of Delray Beach has elected to make the people who live right along the intercoastal waterway move their trash to the next street for pickup so the trucks don't get damaged. So, you know, as more and that, more and more of that goes on, you know, people by word of mouth or other means will start realizing that this is a problem here and now that has to be addressed. Hopefully it will be in time for the election. At least that's what my hope is.
Thank you, Bob. Andrew, you're in a different climate there. You've got a political issue going on, and you said the present prime minister isn't bringing it out at all. Can you tell us a little bit more about the opposition, or where is climate concern showing up in Australia?
Oh, tell me a bit more about the opposition. Our former prime minister was a man named Tony Abbott, who was extremely right-wing and polarizing. Turnbull, the current prime minister, had made important statements about climate change a few years back, but now that he's become prime minister, he seems to be, on the one hand, hostage to the right-wing faction of his own party, and totally devoted to big business. I mean, it's more than climate change, it's, as you would well know. Yes, the Labour Party is making it an issue, so in that sense, this will be an election about climate change.
Ah, wow.
Yeah.
Well, what are the actions of the Labour Party to make it about climate change if the opponent isn't talking about it at all?
They talk about it.
Okay.
In their campaigning, and also, of course, we have various green groups that also are going to do talk about it. And,
okay.
Be the people who will hear the conversation would be the swing seats, which will get a lot of attention from everybody. So there'll be door knocking and all that stuff.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. And I was curious, Larry, I cut you off there because of the pattern that we're using for introductions, but having spoken with Linda, I have a little sense of what the challenges are in Tucson is you don't have water and fish in the streets.
Actually, I think Tucson is one of the best places that will be habitable if the, you know, as climate change becomes to get more and more worse. We do have enough water if we would conserve it. And we don't have any of the floods or fires or any of those things. But my concern, I've been concerned with this now for 5 decades. It keeps changing the local scenes about it. And I believe that we're in a crisis of crises, not just one crisis. It is true that climate change would be majorly catastrophic. In fact, the worst case scenario says we'll be extinct in 15 years. Now, that's low probability, but not much we're going to do about that. But I feel that the issue is not humankind on climate, it's humans with themselves. I do not see the existing leadership structure, governments or corporations, capable of making the decision. That means I feel that if you want to, you know, stop the climate thing, we literally have to have a global revolution, a global change, and get rid of those. No matter, as long as we take actions and think that those people in charge are going to somehow make a decision. No, they are right now. I mean, Obama's proposals are nothing that's going to be real. These are, in my view, simply appeasement. And what scares me is that if the people on top are aware of climate change, their solution is, number one, a 95% reduction of the human species would save us, or that they let it happen, and we have the technology to build domes, completely housing people with mechanisms going to the domes, and let the world go to pot in between. And many of these people are leadership are so interested in their human things that they're doing with themselves, they don't give a damn about nature. And this is real scary stuff. There are people so aware of what's happening now that they've given up, and they are organizing to die, have the species die well. Sherilyn Baker, Andrew Harvey, they don't see any solution.
So from where I'm sitting and my Mary Sunshine perspective that takes me through life, I like to look at that Chinese symbol of crisis and opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
And where I am heading is, since I'm on this fascination of who are we anyway as human beings, I look at climate change as a distinct invitation,
right,
to truly wake us up. You know, we got to be pinched. We got to be really hurting, or we just going to doze off here. So for me, I love this question about the electoral issues and climate concerns, to again look at this as an opportunity to bring on what we have learned about ourselves as human beings, what we've learned about behavior, what we've learned about the science of fields, like Bob was addressing. We don't have to get anybody to do anything. What we want to spend our energy on is cultivating these fields where climate conversations can be accepted. And I'm particularly drawn to those courageous Republican leaders in public eye who are willing to step out there. And I'm proud to say my U.S. representative from my district, Representative David Jolly, has actually spoken out to say climate change is real and we're part of it. And the other part of the other reason I particularly think of him as a climate champion is he's actually running for the U.S. Senate. So he's going to need the establishment's money to get elected, but he's choosing a different path. So it'll be a fascinating thing to follow.
Well, I would like to say that the dismal perspective, I said, I'm really an optimist. 5 years, decades ago, I came up with a means, and I'm just going to give some words. I said, uplift through societal metamorphosis, and that we can do it in 2 decades. But the crisis is such that our solution must be commensurate with the crisis. We have to do something beyond our imagination of anything done, not to nibble around at it, but say we have the potential to really do this. We got to be aware of it, though. And
Nancy, I bet you're sitting there with all kinds of ideas. Can we hear some of them?
Pardon?
No, I'm asking Nancy. We haven't heard from her. She's right. Been so quiet.
Uncharacteristically quiet is what she means.
But I know you're not asleep.
So, first of all, let me tell you my objective situation here. I'm at my office, and several hours ago, with absolutely no warning or even telling me they had done it, I backed into discovering they had turned the electricity off. They're doing work outside. So my phones don't work, my computer, nothing works here, and my cell phone, which fortunately I had recently charged, is working, but it also tends to run down quite quickly. So I'm hopeful that I have 2 hours worth of charge on it, but if I suddenly disappear, you will know what has happened. I haven't yet been swallowed up by a tsunami or forest fire or earthquake. It's merely the electricity not being here.
Well, thank you. So go ahead with the question.
Yeah, so I find it helpful in my own thinking to pull apart. There are so many strands connected to climate change, so many different kinds of initiatives, so many different sectors having different pieces of the puzzle, as such that there are times when saying what's happening with climate change is a meaningful question, but often I'll get the wrong answers, because if they're not using the code word climate change, if someone, for example, is talking about energy alternatives or resilience or emergency preparedness, or in our case in Santa Cruz, we've always dealt with homelessness, but now we're dealing with more and more freezes, people freezing to death in the winter. And that has become a huge focus of people's political concerns and social actions here. So I'm looking for the connections. Another focal point here is race, and race quickly turns into issues of poverty and racial justice, and that turns into issues around climate justice. So often it's kind of nibbling at the edges, or of course in California, agriculture, water, snow, forest fires, the state of the oceans, what's happening to the fisheries here. All of these things are matters of concern, and they can be matters of a particular interest group, and the politicians appealing to that interest group may well be addressing those issues with more or less awareness of them as a subset of the larger whole.
I see.
So that's how I find myself rethinking the question, and I'll just say one last sentence, but it gets us into other parts of today's conversation, which is, what are the kinds of actions that people are drawn to or can gain an appreciation of around the things that they can at least wrap their minds around that may in fact contribute to the solutions, even though not with the label climate change and in coming at it from a different political angle often. I'm done.
Thank you. Well timed. It looks like we're having the group step back up and join us. And it looks like we have Lucas. Hi, Lucas.
Hi, everyone.
We're glad you're part of this. We have just experienced, I think, you'll get to hear the tales of our breakout session. Welcome back, everybody. How did that work? Before we get back into the debriefing the topic, I want to hear how the technology worked. Linda says good.
Worked pretty well.
Good. So thank you, everyone, for digging into this question. And I'll just allow you to, if you will, raise your hand as a person that wants to speak next. And those of you who are on the telephone, I am not sure how to recognize you. So my suggestion is you'll just have to interrupt, okay? So everybody, I know we had a chance to talk and meet with each other, and the question being how the electoral issues and climate concerns are converging, or if they are not. So what did you pick up? Did you learn anything new that you hadn't heard before? There's Bob.
Well, I guess I'll go first while everybody else is thinking of a response. I think the conclusion was that our political leaders are not the place to look for action. They're followers, not leaders, based on what the grassroots wants to do. So it's up to us at the grassroots to put enough pressure on leaders in industry and business and government to make some things happen. But Larry also talked about that we have a crisis of crises facing us right now. And I certainly believe that's true, starting with the most fundamental one, which is population. The Earth was not designed for a population of 7.5 billion people, let alone the 9 billion expected of in 2050. I don't think it's going to get to that unless we really gain some traction on some of these long-term issues that we face as a civilization. That's what I heard basically from the conversation.
Thank you.
This is Andrew. I'm going to make an abstraction from our conversation, and I was delighted to, delighted in it. You'll get the idea of it. But several of us commented that on the fragmentation, so many different aspects to climate change. So I was really pleased that in this conversation, people are seeing a need for, to put a positive spin on it, for what I would call a whole system change. Finding a language and a way to deal with all the different factors conceptually. The take I take on it is a really useful meme might be we are transitioning to a life-sustaining society and then unpacking what that means.
Thank you. Hi, Marty. Take yourself off. There you go.
Hi. You know, our group talked about a lot of new things, and some of them tied into, I think, what our next question is going to be, some exciting convergences that are people-led, which maybe Lanny or Brady will want to speak to. But I just want to mention that one disconnect that I feel is happening right now is the disconnect of messages like that coming from candidate Trump around how, if elected, he will bring coal back, and how that there is a significant portion of people who hear that message and it's a message of hope. And that's a real disconnect of understanding right now among the people that have to be the ones to make the change about what we really need to be doing. So it's a disconnect that I think is an opportunity that's challenging for us to look at, but it's one I think we have to look at and say there, because there's other ways for those people to have hope and for those people to transition. But the quick fix is to have the dream that you can go backwards.
Oh. Thank you.
I'm complete on that.
Okay, Larry, what about you?
Yeah. Although I'm basically very long-term and don't believe that the United States is going to be able to do too much. On the other hand, in this election, back when there were three Democratic candidates, I tried to propose that we try to move to a team POTUS, that Clinton, O'Malley, and Sanders, that they somehow say that, you know, the complexity has gotten to the state that no one single person can be POTUS anymore. And that would be a radical kind of thing to which we can talk about the fact that the United States is really dead in the water right now. I mean, we talk about deadlock, but it's more than that. I'm concerned that some major event is going to be manufactured in the United States before the elections, which could shift things. I'm concerned about the fact that the electoral processes will be so manipulated that at the end of the election, it's thrown into the Supreme Court, which may still be 4-4, and we're in a constitutional crisis that nothing can come out of. This is much more right now, the process is going on. This is a phenomenon, this electoral process going on, which is totally different than anything before. And I think recognizing that, it is possible that some leverages could be made to really move things different. But I feel that somehow, although I really have, I mean, I'm very suspect of Hillary, particularly with what she did in Libya, right now, I think a kind of a negotiation between Hillary and Bernie is needed. And I don't know what can be done to bring that about. But to me, that is the most important thing right now as towards the election.
Thank you, Larry. And I see Grady, you're raising your hand. And David, you were doing a little spark over there. So I'll pick you up next, David.
In our
Grady, your turn.
Yes, in our small group of three with Marty and Lenny, I think Lenny gave an interesting example of a convergence. It did involve politicians being out front in Florida. I won't try to summarize it. Maybe he'll choose to. But it was an example of someone reaching across the aisle to form a Republican-Democrat coalition on behalf of the environment and to try to tilt Florida, which has every reason to tilt concern in the election about the about climate change, tilt Florida in the direction of candidates who are thinking along those lines, like Hillary or Bernie, whoever it is.
Thank you. David? David Sinclair, are you on mute?
No, I'm not on mute. I already have nothing to summarize. Bob did a wonderful summary there. I think it's the other David who's trying to get in.
Okay. David, are you trying to get in? From Irvine? No?
There are several Davids on the call. Actually, just to say that one thing that I think it was Guy had said that was, I guess, good news to me was that that solar energy and wind energy is now cheaper than coal. So market pressures would help to drive a conversion from that. So that was the first I heard that. So that was interesting.
Thank you. Linda, were you raising your hand? Okay. You're back on mute. There you go.
One thing that stood out in our conversation for me was that it seems like the national scene, we just don't talk about it. It's just mute altogether. But at the local scene, it is more possible to talk about it. But even there, the print media seems to be more receptive. The TV media, I think because of the consolidation, they just don't talk about it. It's just like there's this unspoken, gag message that we don't talk about it, which is probably because of the funding interests of big oil. It's very sad.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think the media is, we have to recognize that all the media is manipulated so that we cannot necessarily say the things that we want to say or point out what we want to say. For example, I think methane right now is a far more dangerous item in our climate change than carbon dioxide. And that's not, I mean, even the environmentalists aren't bringing that up very much. And as for the immediate election, I saw a very detailed analysis presentation of the blow-by-blow things that happened in Nevada. And without question, the Hillary's group there were vicious in suppressing Bernie at that convention. But even MSNBC said it was kind of equal and they were going to win. So we're not getting the information out because the media won't let some of it come through.
And I'd like to, Lenny, I think you're dark. I can't see you too much, but I think I saw your fingers across some light. So
yeah, there, that's a little better.
Indeed, there you go.
Afternoon light coming in. Yes, methane is 10 times more powerful than carbon dioxide, but it's the carbon dioxide. There's so much more of it being released than methane is right now. As far as the media is concerned, it depends on where you're at. The Sun Sentinel, the Miami Herald, the Florida, South Florida TV stations, as Bob and a few of the other folks know, they have been pretty consistent on running climate change stories because they're ground zero down there. And they have the most to lose if there are 5 to 6 million people, including our friends down there, who have to get up and leave. Most of the, a good deal of the climate folks that I know, for a long time, I was one of the first climate change folks down there, working on the mayors at the beginning, joining the National Conference of Mayors Climate Change, group, working, talking to mayors. They're leaving, they're selling their properties and getting out because they don't feel that that we can make it. Now, on the CCL meeting on Saturday, James Hansen was the phone guest. And he was talking about the new the science that they're following on the slowdown of the Gulf Stream coming off of the ice melt and water temperature changes in Greenland, which he sounded kind of very concerned about, which when you know about it, it is deeply concerning because that could really shut down a lot of things. But in saying all that, let me say that, you know, we have an opportunity here. And if now's the time to mention it, the opportunity is that we get Florida to decide, make a decision, the Floridians to decide what they believe and what they want to do for their future. And that is to support candidates who understand climate change and the danger it is to the millions of people who live on the coastlines in Florida, and will only support and vote for candidates of any party that will that understand the problem and that are going to create solutions and not pull back from where we are, because Florida can't afford it. It just, you know, you live in Pinellas County. You can't afford 4 years. The train's already 25 years down the road with the amount of carbon in the atmosphere. And what's going on in Antarctica and Greenland is just accelerating at a massive pace. So the stand we have to take is the stand of Florida raising its voice and saying the answer is no. The answer is we want to survive here, and what the repercussions will be economically and emotionally if 5 to 6 million people are told in 10, 15, 25 years that they got to leave. If a big hurricane comes through where Bob lives, the insurance companies, he knows it, the insurance companies have already said in Miami, they're not going to reissue homeowners insurance down there. Right. So because they won't be able to stop the flooding. So we have a battleground, and we have a chance to turn the election with the state that matters. I'm in Nashville. They don't give a crap about Florida or climate change up here. I'm telling you. That's why I'm going to Gainesville to get with Sue and David and lots of folks down there, and CCL's on board with Aditha and her folks. And we're going to fight the best fight we can.
Thank you.
Over the next 6 months to take those 29 electoral votes and put it in the hand, and senators and all the way down the list, people who want to solve work on this problem.
Thank you very much. And we love having more. Come on down, because we're taking action. And like Bob said, it's up to us. It's up to the grassroots folks. We've got to step up. And Guy and I are both part of a conversation that began back in October, hosted by St. Pete College, to address sea level rise. What's our next move? And we had a conversation. We actually had a World Cafe to let people find each other, to demonstrate what networking was like back in March. And now we're planning an event June the 3rd. And back to our political theme, we've asked our U.S. Representative David Jolly to open up the conversation that afternoon. He's one of those rare Republicans who stood up and taken the heat for it, because he's running for the U.S. Senate. But he said, climate change is real, and we've done it.
So we're stepping up to it. We're delighted to have more people down. And I realize we want to stop and give some more time to the next question before we wrap this up.
Before you leave this, this is Nancy. I'm going to jump in on the phone. As you said, I want to say that out here in Santa Cruz, in this area, we are doing some serious organizing to support the congressional resolution that the Republicans that you're talking about are taking a lead in to simply affirm, yes, climate change exists, and also to support the prepare measure. And one of the things we have to do in our discouragement that we can get into about electoral politics is not miss the leadership that is there and make sure that we're doing our job to support it and talk about it with everybody and build it up. I'm done.
Thank you. That's the Gibson resolution you're talking about, right, Nancy? From New York State?
Yes, it is. It is.
And that was in part because of the support and encouragement from CCL, Citizens Climate Lobby. Correct, Marty? Great, great, great. Good stuff, folks. We get another delicious question. So everybody's cool with the process? And I think it's appropriate that we give ourselves another 20 minutes. We've got two questions this time. So again, pay attention to the other people in your group. Listen for what other people might have to offer. And here's the question. And then Linda's going to break us into our groups. Or Bob is, I guess. Are you putting different groups this time or the same groups?
I tried to mix them up a little bit. I couldn't do much with the main table folks because they're on telephone. So, but I did mix up the table one and table two. Make sure that you're somewhere. I tried to do the best I could while I was taking notes. So I think I got everybody.
Thank you so much. This is great. This is great adventure. And again, we've got this terrific technology. Thanks to Lucas and Bob and this team here from D&D Can that's brought this to life. So here we go. Next questions. This time you got two. What roles do skill process work and intentional conversations play? What roles do skills process work and intentional conversations play in accomplishing these goals? So what we'd like to hear now is what's working in your experience, and how is it working? So you got that, and have you written that in the chat, anybody?
I did. Yeah, it's there. Perfect.
Thank you, Linda. So ready, set, go.
All right, see you in the room.
You've got 20 minutes.
Well, maybe I can speak to our group.
Let's see. Lloyd and David, you're going to be jumping off, right?
No, David's staying here. David Sinclair is on phone.
Right. David Friedley, is that how you say your name? You're on mute.
Oh, I'm almost out.
Oh. And
I'm trying to.
You're going to, I don't see what table you're supposed to go to.
He's table
two. Table two, but it's asking me to sign in.
You mean, what is asking you to sign in? Zoom?
Yeah, Zoom Cloud Meetings is asking me to sign in again.
Did you, yes. Okay, let me.
I'm just signing out.
Well, you shouldn't have to sign into Zoom. You should just go there automatically.
So
I'm just trying to think about what the best way for you to get there is. I would say, Lucas, can you hear me? No, he's not available right now. Why don't you go out, close your browser session, the whatever browser you use, close Zoom, come back in, and then go right to table two. Something must be hung up on your computer.
Bye, David.
Yeah, bye.
Good luck.
Thank you.
All right, Larry, now to you.
Okay. Again, I try to see things from now in the local to when we're finally successful. I feel that all of our processes are grossly inadequate. But they're the ones we have to work with right now. All I'm going to say is that at this point, I feel we need to have a more of what I call a synergy between real time and delayed time. Here we're kind of working, you know, together in this, but the material is coming out now in learning change, P2P Foundation, Joe Brewer stuff. Is beginning to accelerate at an enormous rate, unable for us to process, any person to process all this information. But it is going to be very useful for what we're doing, and we need new apps. At the same time, we need to use the apps we have better.
Okay, what I'd ask you to do, please, Larry, is on that chat space.
I don't see the chat space. I came in here through the back door, and so let's for this session.
I was hoping that you will then send us an email with the names of these groups that you just mentioned, please.
Oh.
Because that's too good. You know, we want to find out who these people are and what they're doing. Anybody else have a perspective about this process, these process technologies?
Yes. Yes. I do. This is David in Minnesota. May I speak now?
Please speak, David.
Yes. What I enjoyed about your question, Sharon Joy, is that you said intentional conversation. So I think that the skills needed for intentional conversation to get our issue moving clearly includes a mode that many know called World Cafe, which is a form of conversation. Those unfamiliar can check it on Google. It allows people to converse with respect for each other on issues. Also, I think that the skills exist. We do have, as a community, the ability to organize when there's a hurricane. I think we can also use those skills to organize on issues like climate change, particularly. We do have, and we need to emphasize, the skills of nonviolent direct action. This is nothing new. Our community does understand those tactics and those modes and those skills. And finally, I think that we need to try very often not only to attend conversations and attend symposia, attend educational events on climate change, but more importantly and finally, we need to speak up. We need to not be silent in these public events and emphasize the need for more attention to action steps. We do as a community know our roles. We know the skills that are there. We just need to be a little more courageous. Thank you.
Thank you, David. As you're speaking, David, about hurricanes and what we know about hurricanes, yes, some of us do. We've had a lot more Floridians come here since our last onslaught of hurricanes, so that they're new to it. But what came to mind as you were speaking was my memory about being involved with Y2K.
Yeah.
And what we learned from that process work. And what I will tell you is, because I was very involved here and nationally, is that holding a place for people to come and express their fears and their concerns, a place to come and be seen, heard, and be able to speak. You know how sometimes it just rolls around inside of you, and then you get a chance to tell somebody, that energy comes out of your body and it doesn't feel quite as bad. So that's one of my memories, is holding some of these circles, although I was doing strategic work also. The impact on the individuals of being able to speak. So that's one of the process tools that work, circles, and like you said, David, the World Cafe. Well, that's me.
This is Andrew, just picking up on this notion of intentional conversations. I've approached it from a little different angle. I think it's quite difficult and yet simultaneously critically important for people to get the whole picture in mind, to connect the dots, not be so fragmented in our thinking. So the approach I've taken is to develop something called the kitchen table conversations, which is a set of physical models that people can use in structured conversations to think through the things we need to change to have a pretty positive future. So it's a training approach more than an open conversation approach, but it's definitely a conversation.
Andrew, thank you. I'm curious, now that you've brought that into this conversation, are you connected up with Alan down in, was he in Melbourne?
Alan who? No, doesn't ring a bell.
The conversaires, the conversations?
There's an online academic forum called The Conversation. Is that what you mean?
No. Are you connected up with the network called Open Space?
No.
You're not familiar with dialogue process called Open Space, okay? I think in your
I know open space technology in conferences and stuff, yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm going to be sure that you get the link, Andrew, to open space, because there's a lot of conversation that goes on around these intentional conversations, because again, we're all part of a dialogue community, a global community.
Yep.
And Alan is there in Australia, and he's been hosting these conversations for a long time. So I'll be sure to connect you up with Alan also. I think he's in Melbourne, but I'm not positive.
Thank you. Good.
Yeah. Shall do. David, is that you?
It is not David Sinclair. Maybe it's the other David.
Oh, it is. It is your phone that flashes, but you don't want to speak. Okay. Nancy, haven't heard from you.
I'm right here. I've really, really enjoyed the answers coming to these questions. The couple of things that are occurring to me, I'm particularly interested these days in the networking and what I've recently heard called collective impact efforts to bring together many different activist groups, individual causes with each other and also with existing networks like faith-based networks and other established paths of communication in a given community to look at. I think people have been talking today about a crisis of crises, and this is, as you've heard, the movement of movements, the effort to see the connect the dots, see the connections between the different concerns people have that will draw them, and how the actions different groups or individuals take can be made coordinated and, even more importantly, synergistic in leveraging each other's work that is very, very challenging kind of intentional conversation, to be very tuned in to the tensions that arise in trying to do that and use all the skills we have to create spaces that are safe and processes that allow that kind of coordination among people who are on the same side of an issue, but coming at it with different histories and approaches and so forth. Alongside that, and related to it really, is also the bridging political differences, finding language and venues and contexts for bringing people who see themselves politically quite different from each other and yet have a great deal in common together in common cause around things that they can agree on. Again, I think our ability to cultivate those skills is an absolutely central part of the contribution that we can make, not both to climate and to the larger social questions that we've been talking about. That's it.
Thank you. Let me get clarity. You mentioned a collective impact. Is that a coalition? Is it something that is someplace to be found on the internet, or was that a
term? It's a term I've recently come across, which I was attracted to because it seemed to be a label for something I've been valuing but didn't quite have a name for. You may recall one or two conversations ago, several of you, we were talking about REAMP, and Beth, I've forgotten, Landis, I'm forgetting her last name right now, who's also done similar work in Putney. It's essentially when you get different sectors and, say, philanthropic groups and activist organizations and different sectors of a community or parts of a movement to come together and, in a very systematic and careful way, take the knowledge they have about the systems they're trying to change and sort it out so that they have a good understanding of the underlying dynamics in those systems, and then can arrive at strategically well-selected places to put their joint efforts, their joint money, their joint political organizing, their joint educational efforts, their focused action, targeting specifically strategic, powerful places, and then see some substantial systemic change occur as a result of it. I'm very taken by the evidence of those that I'm seeing, such as REAMP itself, which stopped so many coal plants across 8 states in the Midwest, but I didn't have a name for it. And just recently, I came across something called Living Cities and several other different networking organizing efforts, and they used the term collective impact for what they were trying to do. That's where that comes from.
Thank you. And when you get your computer back, will you be sure this gets added to our notes, Nancy?
Yes, ma'am. I will.
Very, very good. Lucas, are you part of the conversation? Nope.
Let me put something more in if no one else is. For a long, long time, I felt there's a great limitation to conversation. Part of it is that it's very difficult to access, to record a conversation and access it in a way that is meaningful. At the same time, I feel that conversation between two minds that are resonating can be some of the most exciting things to be done, but they're seldom recorded at the time they are done. I feel we need to explore a lot of different modes of interactivity. I think that some type of dialogue needs to be done around the construction and the editing of, I call them semiotic structures, a piece of text with diagrams. I remember once, a long time ago, someone pointing out that physicists had a style where they would stand around a chalkboard, and the chalkboard was there for them all to see, and they kept maneuvering the things on the chalkboard while they talked. Now, that was never recorded, but I think we have the technology now to be able to craft and improve the things that people would read and study and have the dialogue being done during the collective construction of that. And the dialogue then be edited and be part of that itself. I think that's critically needed, and it can help keep focus on the conversations that are going on around something that they're mutually constructing.
Well, actually, Larry, the good news is that Lucas has designed that as part of this Kiko Chat platform. If you look down at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a line that has the mute button, the video. If you go across to the right, there's a piece that says share screen.
Yeah.
Okay. Last week, I had a meeting with a couple of colleagues who were actually editing a final product of a World Cafe session that we had hosted, putting together a summary of it to share with everyone. And so that was not a mathematical or a physics formula, but it was one person shared her screen and the other two were looking at the screen while we were looking at each other, just like we're doing now. So it exists right now in Kiko Chat. Isn't that incredible?
Yeah. It needs to be, you know, made. And one of the things about technology, which this we're right now, this Zoom session is good, but many of us, including me, I'm not trained to use it yet. And some of us learn in different styles. And to me, technology is tools, techniques, training, teams, and time. And all of those need to be woven together to make use of the technologies. But yes, I'll have to look into that. Thank you.
Yes.
Hey, Sharon, sorry, this is Lucas. I have been listening. Sorry, I was on mute when you called on me last. And I appreciate Nancy bringing up collective impact, which makes me think I should kind of reach out to some of those groups. I did go to a collective impact conference at Stanford. And I think that it's such a fascinating theory. I think it offers a lot of potential. But what I've seen from collective impact organizations, the key is they have a backbone that is full-time and the rest is peer-to-peer, community-oriented, but they don't truly have a bottom-up and open space kind of ethos for self-organization. So I think that there's a lot they can do. I've only maybe heard of about a dozen of them, but I'm going to look into that more. Thanks.
Great.
Lucas, let me add two things. One is, the way I backed into it, the technology Kumu that I'd love to talk with you more about, I'm just starting to experiment with it, and when I'm a little more on top of it, I'm going to bring it into our DD Can and a couple of other places. I promise I'll explain another time. I don't want to try to right now, but I did want you to know that, and maybe we can talk about it more. I also wanted to respond to what Larry was saying. Another thing I'll mention specifically is climate interactive. And one of the things technology permits that only has come into my lifetime and not before, to be able to understand how complex variables are interacting to produce results. And I had to know calculus or beyond calculus to be able to even begin to read anything that could help me understand those interactions. But now, the ability to go in, have a software that allows you to do what, in the case of Climate Interactive, they do. They hand a group of students or policymakers or citizens some software embedded in a game that says, if you were to make this kind of climate decision as a policymaker, here's what the long-term consequences would be. And it shows up within a couple of minutes using software called a slider. You just slide different variables up and down and start seeing outcomes. And then you have those conversations around that shared image
Larry, and Climate Interactive has done this now on a global scale, but they have a new series out that people can use locally for their local communities. So I just wanted to mention those two technology advances that could really deepen the conversation in the way I hear you asking for. And then,
thank you, Nancy. And what you don't know is that the other two groups have joined us, so they got to hear your offer. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Wow. I'm curious what happened in the other two groups. So we've got about a half hour on my clock to finish up. I know we want to leave some time for some networking, sharing stuff, but we definitely want to have a time for debriefing. So let's, what had you scheduled, Marty? How long do you feel like you need?
Okay. As far as I can tell, that they have things to share. So I'd say we need probably maybe 10 minutes to see if we have events, opportunities, networking that we want to let each other know about, that we need support with, or we want people to join.
Thank you.
Maybe 10, 15 minutes.
Linda, what about you? Did you have anything that you wanted to address in the wrap-up that we want to? So I'm just going to back into how much time we have here.
Yeah, I think we have about 15 minutes for networking and our final round. Be fine.
All right. So who wants to start? What did you learn? What surprised you? Linda.
Just since I have my mute off, I may as well jump in. So it was just Grady and myself. I'm not sure what happened, but that's fine. We had a lovely talk. And I think the exciting thing for me is I'm returning. We talked a lot about how there really are opportunities at the state level, certainly where Grady is I think you're in Massachusetts, right, Grady? So he's finding that CCL, for instance, there's some legislation going on there that's CCL related. And things really are happening there, I'm sorry. And not so much for me in Arizona, unfortunately. It's pretty locked down in terms of solar. But I am finding that, and Grady is too, that the opportunity lays really in the building of grassroots will. I'm involved in a couple of activities that are really going at the neighborhood by neighborhood level, as well as in the local business community. There's a lot of small businesses, as well as we've taken on the U.S. Green Chamber program called Advance, coupled that with some volunteer students from the U of A Architectural College. They're helping local businesses to actually reduce carbon footprints. We're not waiting around for business. For funding or for the government. We're just going for it.
Great.
So that's encouraging. And Grady gave me some great ideas to think about in terms of finishing my book, which is all about re-empowering the citizen voice using dialogue. So anyways, that was much of our conversation. Jump in, Grady, if I didn't get something.
Grady, did you want to add something there?
Just that, the opportunities that exist at the local and grassroots level for it's easy to feel disempowered if you just think about how little leadership we're getting in Washington on climate change. But I've seen local groups bring pressure to bear on their legislators at the state level and make a real difference, and just turn people around who otherwise had been listening just to the utility industries, the fossil fuel interests. But when they begin to hear the other voice, it can make a big difference. So I feel hopeful.
Thank you. Now, again, those of you on the telephone, if you want to jump in.
I think that might be Nancy trying to talk. I'm not sure. She's got her mute off. I'm not sure.
It is not me.
Okay, sorry.
Well, I'll jump in because speaking of conversations, intentional conversations and processes. Here in the Tampa Bay area, there is an alert, thankfully, because we have politicians who've been elected and they are listening. And we have engaged citizens who are taking action. We have regional planners who are taking action. And just like we opened up with, the media way behind everybody else so far. That's an issue. And I picked this up from one of this team that I'm working with on Sea Level Rise, and I will post it. I'll send it so you have that. But I'm going to share this because respecting people's time, I want to be sure we get these out. Our issues we recognize is you don't talk to the business community the same way you talk to the Tampa Bay Watch. You don't talk to the educators in the way that you're talking to the kids. And recognizing there's different cultures, different values, different priorities. Generally, from what I've learned, most writing is done to an eighth grade level. And the second piece is we are learning that data is not engaging. And too many progressives speak in the language of data and people can't hear you. So here's a framing list of eight guiding principles that we're using, trying to keep ourselves together. And again, I'm going to share it, put it online so you'll all have it, plus the link. And it says to focus on local with observable impacts. In our small group, Bob Steritz, who's in Boca Raton, pointed out that in Delray Beach, the city will not pick up garbage on certain days in certain neighborhoods because the seawater is wrecking the underneath of the garbage trucks that cost, you know, a fortune to buy garbage trucks. So citizens are literally having to bring their garbage to another street for pickup. So that's a local observable fact. Number two, begin with what audiences care about. Again, hit the heart, hit the gut, not the head. Build on nonpartisan values. What does everybody care about? Such as we were talking about today, if your neighbor is having a cardiac arrest, how are you going to get that person to the hospital when you've got these water surges coming in? Tap, number four, is tap uncertainty as a reason to prepare. You don't have to have all the facts. Uncertainty is a reason to prepare. Number five is emphasize the cost of inaction. And Guy, you were in that first meeting back in October, and you remember that subject did come up. Is the cost of action, yes, people are talking about it being so expensive, but then you talk about the cost of no action. So that's number five. Number six is to promote practical solutions. And I will add something I think is important and we're starting to entertain here is short-term solutions and long-term. Like, Bob, didn't you mention that they're refurbishing the beaches in Miami? Which they need to bring the tourists there now because they need those bucks for their taxes.
Well, that's every 2 or 3 years, all the beaches are refreshed because the storms wash the sand out to sea. So
long-term, of course, like you said, the raised roads and so forth. I don't know how far that's going to get you. Number seven is articulate what will get better if action is taken. And finally, promote mitigation as a preparation strategy. So I will share these for you all to listen and read on your own. But the language, the conversation, and how you engage people, more it's the why and why should I care than the data? So that's what we're learning here in our intentional conversations. Thank you.
I need to jump in because I have a 6 o'clock conference call I need to jump in on, so I need a few minutes. I really enjoyed today, and I know South Florida Audubon is heavily involved in replanting the berms along the coastline, sea oats and other things in order to help hold the beach in place. That's going on, but you're right. Ultimately, they're not going to stop the water anywhere around there because of the limestone. So, I enjoyed it, and I look forward to the next one, and you'll be hearing more from Sue and I and David on the Float the Vote campaign, and we hope to make a difference and invite you to climb aboard, as they say in the sailing world.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Have Thanks a peaceful day. Planning. Bye-bye.
And Grady, are you raising your hand? Yes, please.
Yes, I am. I wanted to build on your first point about data not being an effective thing to at least emphasize in conversations. Some of the coaching that I've received in trying to learn how to best communicate with people in Congress or in state legislatures is that personal stories that are very, graphic, specific, are quite memorable. And I think it's useful to have the data, but leading with a personal story and is what can really stick with people.
Thank you. Larry? You're on mute.
Okay, there we are. I'm concerned that there's a competition continuously between local and all of various levels up to global. It is true that to first attract somebody to engagement and to work with them, the best thing to do is to do local and use stories. And yes, data tables aren't interesting, but information can be properly presented, but people need to learn how to look at graphs. We got to build in a learning process, and in this, or we're not going to get anywhere. Back in the earlier part, and he just left, he pointed out that methane, yes, is a small component to the greenhouse gases now, although we're going to have to stop eating meat significantly as part of our effort to, I mean, cars, gasoline, yeah, but meat also. But the thing is the methane is starting to percolate up all over the place. There are great big craters in Siberia that are supposedly done by methane bubbles. We can reach a point where methane will trigger runaway global heating, and then anything we do about protecting beaches or anything else is moot. That means we are in this problem because we didn't think ahead. And we got to think beyond our immediate needs of what's going to happen at the local level to survive climate change. That we got to get at the root of what's causing this thing to keep going. We can't begin to repair. Yeah, we need to do some repair, but just repair and make things nice in our local area isn't gonna save.
Thank you, Larry.
Sharon Joy, Andrew here.
Andrew.
So I'd like just to pose a question for you. Given starting local, but then how, by what means, to get people to the big system level that we're just talking about?
How to get to the large system?
Changing the whole system, yeah.
Well, I found great peace in what Bob Steritz offered earlier. I don't know if it was in our small group or to the large group. Is what I find is you collect a focus locally and regionally, and based on scientific research, the micro impacts the consciousness of the macro. I don't know if you've heard about that, and maybe that's another conversation because I know we're running out of time. I will put something on the internet, Andrew, so that you can refer to it. Yep. Because that's given me a lot of peace. And the second part that encourages me is I've applied it in St. Petersburg for 15 years, and it seems to be working. So it's now jumping around the state of Florida, and it seems to be having some impact. Yes, I'll admit I have a bias. Marty.
Just to take a comment on a couple of the comments, and including what Andrew just said. To me, I go back to that thing we've heard forever, think globally, act locally. I think we have to contextualize any of our local actions within a global framework, and you know, continuing education about how we fit into the larger picture is always essential, and that has to be done well. And that's a conversation in itself. And the second comment I want to make between data and engaging at the emotional and values level is it's a yes and there as well. The role of data is critical, but our reactions to the data and being able to elicit from people their heart reaction to what the data is telling them is really what we need to be doing. So throwing a bunch of data at people about how grim it is does nothing unless we use our skills in leading conversations to invite them to go to the implications of that for them, their loved ones, for what they love in this world. So it's a yes and on both of those. I just needed to...
Yeah, I'm going to jump in because I can't raise my hand, and I want to build on what the last couple of people have said. I would love to take the question that was just posed about connecting the local and the global as the focus of our next conversation. There's much wisdom that we can pull together about how to do that, and it is a fundamental question, and we might readily roll into it looking in particular at data stories and how to make sure feelings are dealt with as well as strategic planning. I'm done.
Thank you, Nancy. Bob?
Yeah, in listening to everybody talk, I think all the people that need the information the information is available for those who choose to look at it. My only point is in listening to the conversation, we're on the exponential rise of a curve. And basically, we're on the 29th day of a 30-day period where it's literally the 11th hour. All the talk is nice, but it's really time for action right now, and action on a massive scale. I don't know how to do that when half the population has got their head in the sand and is totally trying to ignore, but I guess when the water is lapping on their front doors, maybe they'll pay attention to it. So, you know, it's nice to try to educate people and bring them along and so on, but in my belief, we're way beyond the point where we need to be educating people. We should have been having this discussion 20, 30 years ago. So I just want to throw my two cents in that I don't think most people realize the sense of urgency when you have a positive feedback loop in terms of how things will escalate over the next 20 years. There may not be anything beyond 20 years from now. That's my opinion of studying this for the last 25 years.
Thank you, Bob. Linda.
Well, I just want to pull our attention back to the fact we've got 10 minutes left. And Marty, why don't you go ahead? I'm sorry to cut it off, but otherwise we're not going to have any time to have some closure. So,
Okay. Well, I'm the closure one. Although Linda's going to tell us a few next steps at the very end. But as we start to close, I want to give it a chance for some final comments that have to be very short. But so if you have something really burning, just hold it for a minute. The most important thing to ask right now, is there anything you want to share that's coming up that you feel is important for others to know, or where you need support, you know, where people could chime in and help you with? Is there an event, some networking opportunity? For example, I think we probably all know the Citizens Climate Lobby Conference is coming in June. If any of you are near D.C. or able to go to that, that's always very powerful convening of people, learning lots. Linda.
I'll write it in the notes. I'm actually going out to Chicago mid-June. It's over the weekend of June 17th through 19th in Chicago. It's called the People Summit. You can Google it. It's an effort by the many people who have been supportive of the Sanders campaign to strategize How do we keep the campaign going? How do we build a national movement, if you will, grassroots movement to move many of his ideas forward? And of course, he's been really the only candidate that's been coming on strong about climate change. So I decided, what the heck, I'm going to go out to that. I'm actually going to lead a session on empowering the citizen voice. So I would love to see any of you there. Let me know if you're going to go. It'll be fun to get together.
Will you put that on? Will that be in our notes, or will you put that on the Kiko chat site as well?
Yeah, I'll put it up. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anyone else have any upcoming? Did I hear a voice?
Yes, Andrew here.
Hi, Andrew.
I'm beginning to organize a great transition communication blitz for March next year. The prospectus is in the documents on our site. The idea is to get thousands of organizations and their members, well, tens of thousands actually, or whatever, all talking about systemic change. So how to do that is outlined in the prospectus. Love for you all to have a look at it.
Great. Great. Do you want us to give you some feedback and interact with you on it? Is that the whole?
Oh, sure. Sure. Great.
Okay. Excellent. I want to just share one thing. It's coming up the end of this week, but I'm going to an interesting gathering called Resist Climate Change that was organized by the Albert Einstein Institute in Silicon Valley. And it was an institute formed by nonviolent social change strategist Gene Sharp, whose writings on nonviolent tactics and strategy contributed to peaceful social change in a number of countries trying to overthrow dictators. And the summit is bringing together a really diverse collection of climate change activist groups, from groups that are doing a lot of direct action to groups like Citizens Climate Lobby that are working more on electoral strategies. And the idea is to learn about this methodology and approach, which includes developing a grand strategy, and then find out how the climate movement can use that information to further integrate and break down the silos and create a stronger overall movement. So I will be happy to report back on anything that comes out of that to our Kiko chat site. I'm sure I'm going to learn a lot, and I'm hoping that I'll be really inspired and have some new angles for working on this.
Could you say the name, place, date again, and could you be sure that it's sent out to us in Kiko chat or however, so we've got it?
I can, but it's not open at this point. It's not an open event.
Oh, it's a closed thing. Thursday night. Got it. All right.
So there will be follow-up, though. There's going to be this was mainly a training and an orientation with small group discussions of climate activists on how can we, trying to really think very creatively and innovatively of how can we use nonviolent social change theory, which informed all the great social movements of our times, from King and Gandhi and Cesar Chavez, how can we use that and apply it in climate change? So there will be some follow-up activities, and I will make sure that's posted, people know of it.
But could you say again when it is?
It is this Thursday night, all day Friday, and Saturday mornings.
Thank you.
And it's by the Albert Einstein Institute. So you could go and check out them. Anybody could go on the web and check out the Albert Einstein Institute. And I saw that Larry had his hand up.
Yeah, two brief things in terms of the local to global. One is, I find it very interesting that there is literally no strategizing in the long term. Nobody is even imagining any scenarios that are going to take place. The corporations can still do their strategizing, and people will strategize on a single project, but strategizing of how we're going to do things as we move ahead is in the blind spot of almost everybody. I played with it, and I had the issue with Bob that I don't feel there's a distribution of competencies within the human population right now sufficient to do the job. I've been working on what I call organizing for learning and learning for organizing, that we have to bootstrap ourselves with the competencies at the same time we're taking action. And that could be a topic for later, whether we need to learn more or whether we can act on whether we know already.
Thank you, Larry. Is there anyone that has kind of a burning comment they just weren't able to say yet in all the territory that we've covered today in this meeting as we approach the witching hour here where we're going to end? Any final unsaid comment? Linda, yeah, you have one?
Well, this is just my big thing I'm on right now, which is I think the hope that I'm seeing from this conversation and others is that really we just simply need to empower ourselves. We can't, you know, give up. And all that, I mean, it can be as simple as just starting conversations with strangers around this, because you never know where that's going to lead. And so I love what Grady said about creating, you know, coming from our own heart, our own story, engaging people. To me, that's the blessing of the moment. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Okay, well, let's move on to next steps.
Well, the only thing really I have, if there's no other burning questions or anything anybody wants to leave, our next session is going to be June 21st. I loved what Nancy suggested as the next topic. We'd love to hear from any of you. Send us something. Start a conversation on Kiko Chat if you'd like other conversations, other topics that you're interested in. Let us know. The hosting team is going to be doing a retreat early June. So again, if you have other ideas for what you'd like to see this network become, please let us know. Drop us a line. I think you all have my email, and it's Bob. Can you say a little bit about how people can connect with each other on Kiko Chat or through Kiko Chat?
Well, the easiest way to do it is to just look on the home page where it shows everybody's picture, and if you click on the picture, their profile will come up, and there's a button you can press to send an email to that individual. You can do the same thing. Anybody who's in this event right now, just click on their picture, and the screen will open up, and you can send them an email.
Great. And we will try to get the recording of this session up on our Kiko Chat site as soon as we can. The notes, just so you know, will always be there. We'll never take off these events. So if any of you want to simply see some of what has been written on the notes here, you can just go right in there, and then we usually also take a copy and put them into our resources. If you'd like to add more resources and you don't know how to do that, just give me a holler and I'll walk you through it. It's pretty easy once you get into it. Anything anybody else wants to say about what's coming up?
I just saw one resource was added, and I'm not sure we talked about it. Guy added this. SDSNEDU.org is worth checking out. So I just wanted to make a note of that.
Oh, yes, in the chat. Wonderful.
Yeah.
And I see we got the climate interactives in there.
Yep.
All right. Well, thanks, everyone. Thanks for showing up, being part of this wonderful conversation. I know I learned a lot and feel a little more connected to you all. So thank you. Thank you, Bob, so much for your support. Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Facilitation sharing.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye, Andrew. Bye, everybody.
Goodbye.
Bye, everybody. Good job.
Thank you. Bye, Andrew.